Hello everyone, and welcome to Nettle, the best platform around for distance learning in business, finance, economics, and much, much more. My name is Sava, and today we're going to cover another very important model for stock valuation, that is the dividend discount model, or as it is sometimes called, the Gordon model, that takes the famous concept of discounted cash flows that is frequently used in all areas of finance and applies it for valuing stocks. Well, to understand the core logic of the dividend discount model, we need to imagine what is the reason of us retail investors, individuals like you and me, to buy and hold stocks of particular companies in the first place. Well, what is a stock? A stock is a title of ownership over a fraction of a company. For example, if a particular company has 1 million shares in circulation and we buy just one, we are entitled to control 1/1,000,000th of a company. And for large investors, it might make a lot of difference. If you control a significant proportion of the company's share capital, you can influence corporate decisions at annual general meetings where large shareholders are present. But it's very unlikely that some usual blokes like you and me can manage to do that. And for us, owning stocks is important only to participate in companies' profits. As obviously, theoretically, if you own 1/1,000,000th of a company, you are entitled to 1/1,000,000th of its profits. And how companies manage their profits? What do they do with them? Well, at those annual general meetings, they decide how much of their profits they're going to reinvest back into the company to grow, to expand their operations, and how much are they going to distribute to their shareholders as dividends. And that is the logic. There is nothing more, nothing less to a stock than the future stream of dividends that this company will distribute to the shareholders. So, theoretically, the share price, or at least the fair value of the share price, should be equal to the future stream of dividends discounted to the present day. And the choice of this discount rate is quite important, and we'll return to that later on. But obviously, it's uncertain what will be the future dividends. The company might choose to pay more, the company might choose to pay less, the company might choose to pay nothing at all. Obviously, the company can even go bankrupt and no dividends will be paid after a certain period of time. But to simplify the analysis, what is usually assumed that there should be a certain growth rate in dividends that we could apply to determine at least the expected future value of dividend payments. So if you make this assumption, then the formula looks a lot simpler. We just take the past dividend, notated D here, and we apply the constant growth rate sequentially, and then we discount that at the discount rate, and we can figure out the fair value of the share price today. Well, this summation operator just means that for each year you are figuring out the dividend for that year, just applying the constant growth rate, and you are applying the discount rate to figure out your discount factor. And you're applying that up to infinity. And as some of you might know, that is an infinite geometric series. And if the infinite geometric series is convergent, that is, if the discount rate in this case is greater than the growth rate of dividends, then this infinite series has a finite sum, which would be the fair value of our stock. Applying that, we find that the fair value of the share price today is equal to the expected dividend 1 year from now, so past dividend times 1 plus growth rate, divided by the discount rate of the future dividend stream minus the growth rate in dividend. And for the discount rate, what is usually taken is the required rate of return on this company's stock. As it is very well known in all areas of finance that the discount rate should take into account the risk of your investment. So the best, or arguably the best simple measure of this required rate of return would be the expected rate of return that we estimate using something like the capital asset pricing model, the CAPM. So without further ado, let's apply the constant growth rate model to value three large and quite famous companies. Diageo, Royal Dutch Shell, someone might recall that we used to value this company in one of the first videos, and Intel Corp. So the current market price in pounds are slightly above £31, slightly above £22, and slightly below £44. I've also got their dividend payment history. So how much dividend per share did these companies pay in the last 4 years? And as well as some corporate fundamentals that we'll discuss later on. The easiest way to apply the dividend discount model would be to assume that the dividends the company pays per share will grow at the same rate in the future that they used to grow in the past. That can be a questionable assumption, but if your company is a long-established company that is a value stock, they are growing at a reasonably low rate and the growth is stable, this can be kind of justifiable assumption to make. To figure out whether the dividend growth is stable and applicable, we can calculate the growth rate year to year and see if it drastically changes from 1 year to another. To do that, we need to divide the dividend in 2018 by the dividend in 2017 and subtract one. And we can drag this formula around and apply it to all three companies, to all 3 years. So we can see that for Diageo, the dividend growth rate is surprisingly stable and it always stays around 5%. While for other two companies, not so much. Dividend growth rate for Royal Dutch Shell is even negative in one of the years, whereas for Intel, it's always positive, but the fluctuations are very, very wild. Nevertheless, let's calculate the average growth rate over the last 3 years, and assuming that this will carry forward into the future, try to value those three stocks. So obviously, the 3 year dividend growth rate would be the dividend per share in the last year divided by the dividend 3 years ago to the power of 1/3, as we want the average growth rate across 3 years per annum, and we subtract one. And we get that the growth rate at Diageo is 5% per annum, 5.01 to be precise. And for RDS and Intel, we can also compute growth rates like that. But as I already mentioned, we can trust this figure quite a bit more than we can trust those, as the dividend growth rate historically is much, much more stable for Diageo than for those two companies. Well, let's calculate the future dividend that we are expecting to get at the end of 2019 if we trust this growth rate to be the expected growth rate in the future. So obviously the future dividend would be just the dividend in 2018 times 1 plus the historical growth rate. And we can apply this formula for all the three companies and get the value for the future dividend that we'll get at the end of 2019. And again, applying this formula, we can get the fair value using the historical constant growth dividend discount model. So we just divide future dividend by the required rate of return of this particular stock minus the historical growth rate. And applying this to all three companies, we can see something very, very strange. For Intel Corp, the fair value is negative. What would it mean? Well, remember what I told you about convergent geometric series and how the formula is applicable only if the required rate of return is greater than the growth rate. For Intel, the required rate of return is quite a bit lower at 9% than the dividend growth rate at almost 13%. So it means that this constant growth dividend discount model is simply unapplicable for Intel. And the reason for that is that as your dividend grow at a faster rate than they are discounted, the sum of the discounted dividend payments is infinite. So theoretically, you should be willing to pay as much money for one measly stock in Intel as you are asked. $1 billion? Sure. $1 billion? Sure. Because, well, the discounted cash flows are infinite. And this tells us a lot about how unrealistic it is that any particular company grows at 13% a year indefinitely. You might wonder, is there anything we could do to address this unfortunate issue? Well, there is, and I'll be covering it in the next video. As for now, stay tuned.